Okay, so let's go ahead and get started today. Welcome to my Big Data Hadoop training. Thank you so much for choosing the Hadoop training from my end. So today I'm going to take you very clearly the introduction part to Big Data Hadoop actually, right? So end of this session, you should be in a position to understand what is Big Data and what is Hadoop, the relation between these two. That's what we are here to discuss about that one. Let's go ahead and discuss very clearly before I take you to the next level. Let's go ahead and see what is Big Data actually, right? So there might be a number of definitions for the Big Data. Before I define the Big Data, and one thing that you have to understand here, anytime if you have any questions, every question is a valid question. You can ask me anytime. Okay, so don't feel like it's a silly question or simple question or earlier question. Every question is a valid question. So you are here to learn about Big Data Hadoop. So you can ask anything related to that one. So if I'm not sure, definitely you're going to get more updates from my end later point of time. Okay, so don't worry about that one. We are here to discuss about more about that one. Okay, so now let's go ahead and see what is Big Data actually, right? What is the definition of the Big Data? Before I define Big Data, what is data set actually? What is data set? Right? What is data set? Data set is nothing but a simple, it's a collection of related information. If you are putting some information together, that is called data set actually, right? So if you're seeing, like, I'm just comparing with the 15 years back to today's date actually, right? I'm going to just compare the 15 years back to today's date. So how much data that we used to see 15 years back actually, right? So all the way terabytes of data, right? You know that gigabytes, so we used to see the bytes, kilobytes, megabytes, and gigabytes, terabytes, right? So this is the data that we used to see 15 years back actually. So now we used to see this much of data, right? The data or data set from what, right? We will be having some data sources actually, right? Data sources. So what are the data sources are available? So now you can see very clearly data sources is nothing but they are the one who is going to generate the data for you. Those are called a data sources, right? So for best example for that one is going to be the Amazon, right? Or probably your retail domain data, right? Your healthcare domain data, exactly. Yet banking data, right? Or your stock exchange data, right? Or your telecom data, etc. These are the examples for the data sources, whatever it is, right? Whatever your data is going to be generated from so and so place, that data source, we are going to just say that is a data source which has been generating the data in terms of data sets. And what we are going to do, once your data source is generating the data, we have to have some mechanism in order to retain the data for the future purpose, right? You cannot just hold the data wherever it's been generated. You have to just place, you have to just pull into the warehouse in order to just retain the data for the future purpose. The reason why you have to do that one, we know that because in order to take the business decisions, in order to address your customer complaints, in order to stop your organization from the huge loss, in order to compete with other competitor in the market. So definitely you have to analyze the data. You have to retain the data and you have to analyze your past data to take your future business decisions actually. For that only we have to retain the data actually, right? So definitely we used to use the legacy systems actually. I would say legacy systems or traditional techniques. What are the traditional techniques that we used to have to handle this much of data, right? So these people, when these people are developing these products, Java, right? Mainframes, if you have good amount of data, or C++, or C language, or probably .NET, right? Or probably
or DBMS databases, or probably DB2, right? It will come into the BI tools, right? Or any data warehousing, DC, etc. These are the legacy systems or traditional techniques that we used to have to handle this much of data in terms of storage, in terms of processing, right? Only you can do two things. One is you're going to do either storage or you're going to do the processing. Actually, that's all. You're not going to do more than this one. Actually, you're not going to do more than this one, the data that you are getting here. So now you can see very clearly when you are going to store the data, right? So these people thought these are going to, by the way, work excellent when you are going to see all the way terabytes of data from your data sources. Actually, right? These people thought they are not going to see more than terabytes of data from the data sources in future from these data sources. Actually, so that is the reason these techniques are going to work excellent when you are having the data maximum in terabytes of data. When you start seeing the data in petabytes of data, right, as you know, nowadays, because of these data sources started, or these data sources are being processed by more than what they used to do in 15 years back. So that is the reason the amount of data that we are seeing from these data sources got increased exponentially, actually, from year on year. So nowadays we started seeing petabytes of data, right? 1000 terabytes equivalent to petabytes, exabytes of data, jettabyte of data, yottabyte of data, etc. We started seeing the data in terms of this in size, actually, right? We had the data from these data sources 15 years back this much, but nowadays you can see you started seeing the data in terms of petabytes and exabytes of data from these data sources, actually. Then you can see very clearly here the amount of data that you are getting from these data sources is became in terms of petabytes of data when you are going to again store the data or process the data using these legacy systems. They are started giving some challenges, actually. They are not able to store the data on time, or they are not able to process the data on time using this legacy system, using these traditional techniques that we used to have in the market in order to store the data and process the data, actually. So now basically what you started seeing the issues, storage wise issue is the one issue that we are started seeing, and the processing wise is the another issue, actually. Storage wise issue and processing wise issue, actually. So now you can see very clearly, if you are taking any data set from any data source, if the data set, it does not matter whether it's going to be the petabytes, exabytes or terabytes, right? You got the data set from your data source. If the data source is giving some challenges for your existing or traditional techniques, if it is giving some traditional, or if it is giving some challenges for your legacy system, right, that data set I'm going to call it as a big data. So big data is, again, it is a data set. Actually, big data is a data set. When the data set is giving some challenges for the existing systems in terms of storage wise, in terms of processing wise, then simply we can call the data set as a big data, right? So here you have to understand the definition of the big data. So you should be very clear here. Now, big data is also a data set, actually. A data set, it's a collection of some meaningful information you have put together from your data source that's been generated. But that one, we are not able to store it on time. We are not able to process it on time. So for that reason only, we are calling this one as a big data, right? Hi Maurya, we just defined about the big data. So let me repeat that, okay, in two sentences. But before that, any questions from anyone? Vikram and Pramod, are you clear with the big data definition? Excellent. Good. So now let me just put 2 cents for Pramod, so that he, however he'll be going through the recorded video, but let me put 2 cents. So now I just defined about the big data set. Data set is nothing but if you are going to put some meaningful information together, that time we are going to call it as a data set. The data set size can be, 15 years back we used to see all the way terabytes of data, bytes, kilobytes, megabytes, gigabytes and terabytes of data. And these data sets we can expect from the data sources called, you can see the Amazon retail domain or healthcare domain or banking data or stock exchange or telecom data. These are the data sources where you're going to see the data is being generated. Actually, the generated data, of course, you have to retain the data in order to just to do for your future purpose, right? You can take the business decisions based on the past data only. By analyzing the past data only, you can take the business decisions, or you can analyze the customer complaints, or you can just introduce the correct products on time actually from your organization side actually. So these are the data sources. So in order to process or store the data from these data sources, we used to use, these are the traditional techniques, right? 15 years back I'm talking about. So now 10-15 years back, so now you can see very clearly, right, we can handle this data using these techniques when you are seeing all the way terabytes of data, because these people did not think like when they are developing these frameworks, languages, databases, they did not think like they are going to see the data in terms of this one, petabytes of data, exabytes of data, jetabytes of data or yottabytes of data, etc. They did not expect we are going to see this much of data in future. That is the reason they did not even think about to address that one, right? So that is where exactly the issues have started, the challenges, right? Whenever you are, these data sources started generating the this much of data because of the internet enabled devices or more, or like people who are just accessing the internet enabled devices or became more, that is the reason they started seeing the data is being generated double exponentially from here to here actually. That is the reason they reached all the way petabytes of data, right? Whenever, I mean, forget about whether the data set is the petabytes or exabytes of data, but whenever you are taking any data set from your data source, if the data set is giving some challenges, some trouble for your existing techniques, then the data set simply we can call it as a big data, right? So mainly big data is having two issues actually, right? Big data issues basically. What are the two issues that we have from the big data set? If I'm taking that, which I'm calling that one as a big data, either it has to have the storage wise issue from the legacy systems, or processing wise issue, right? The storage wise issue from the legacy system, or processing wise issue from the legacy systems, or both the things actually. These two systems are these two issues that we have from the big data. So now here you have to understand very clearly, big data is not something, a framework, or it's a language, or it's a database. It's not these things actually. It's a simple data set actually. It's a huge volume of data actually. We are going to see what is that volume or not. This is a huge volume of data that you are seeing from the data source actually. Right, so simply it's a data set only, but using your existing systems to handle this data set, it became the challenging part. That is where we started discussing about the big data. People have started developing the different methodologies, techniques in order to address your big data related issues in the market, because these legacy systems are straining actually. Clear? Any questions now? What is big data and what is the definition for the big data? Are you clear so far? You can ask me, like I said, every question is a valid question. You can ask me even second time also if you are discussing, still if you are having any questions anywhere, please let me know. Without just making sure that we are understanding the current topic, we are not going to proceed further actually. Clear? Okay, you can just confirm using the chart window. Thank you, Pramod. Okay, so now let's proceed further. So now we know that we got Now, what is the big data and what are the issues that we are having actually? So now big data is having the more definitions actually, right? We are going to see one by one using some of the V's actually, right? IBM definition. I'm just covering this one because it's important for the interview as well as the certification actually. IBM definition using 4 V's. Right, IBM big data definition. Big data definition using 4 V's from IBM end. IBM has defined the big data definition using 4 V's actually. So the reason here is the characteristics that they defined, the concept they brought, the characteristics they defined about the data set is really very, very, it's going to make a lot of sense. That is the reason this definition become the more important actually. So let's go ahead and see what are these 4 P's actually. First and foremost thing, the volume of data, right? How much data that you are going to add, that is called a volume of data actually. Then the second thing is going to be the velocity of data. We are going to define these definitions, then I'll take you to the next thing. Velocity of data, right? Speed, at what speed you are trying to add the data from your data source to warehouse actually. Then, right, the next thing is going to be the variety of data actually, right? So it, what kind of data that you are going to add it actually, right? The last one is going to be the veracity of data actually, right? So let's go ahead and see what is each meaning actually. So you know that whenever you are taking any data source, right, from Amazon for example, you're going to add some data from your data source to warehouse actually, right? That is what your volume of data. Let me go ahead and just have, this is my data source and this is my warehouse, right? I'm going to just call this one as a MySQL server. So this is having RAM and hard drive. You know that when I say server, it's not something different thing, it's a machine, it's a powerful computer actually. You have to understand that. And this is going to be the data source, Amazon, and this is going to be the data source actually, right? You can see very clearly you are going to generate the data from here to here and you're going to retain them here actually. So we'll be calling this one as a warehouse also, right? We are going to call this one as a warehouse. So now first V is going to be the volume of data, right? The amount of data that you are going to add from your data source Amazon to warehouse is called volume of data actually, right? V means volume of data. The example for the volume of data is going to be the, right, probably 100 GB, 1 TB etc, right? So it whatever the amount, right, probably you can see the 100 MB of data also. How much data that you are adding from your data source to warehouse is called volume of data actually. The next thing is going to be the velocity of data. Velocity is nothing but at what speed we are trying to add this much of data to the warehouse actually. At what speed we are trying to add the data from the data source to the warehouse. For example, right, 100 GB of data is being added in a day or in a month, in a week probably, or in a month. At what speed, at what frequency you're trying to add the data from your data source to warehouse is called the volume of data actually, right? We have seen the two definitions so far. Any questions so far? Volume, velocity. We have seen these two questions. You should be in a position to answer what is the volume of data that you are having actually. Hi Lakshman, we are just discussing about the big data Hadoop discussions, right? I hope you're going to just go through the recorded videos. Please leave your email ID. I'm going to share this recorded video, but we did not discuss much actually. I just introduced about the big data and we are going to define about the big data actually. Okay.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Sure. So who is your organizer? How you got this link?
Okay. Actually, I have registered online a few days back, so I got an email in this demo call.
From RS Trainings or someone else?
What was that? Sorry, can you come again?
RS Trainings or Keep On Learn, which one is that?
Keep On Learn.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. So far you all three are from the same thing. Okay, except Maurya. Okay, thank you. So now we are just defining about the big data characteristics. Volume of data is nothing but the amount of data that you are going to add from the data source to warehouse is called volume of data. The best example, you can have 100 MB, 100 GB, 100 terabytes, whatever it is. The velocity is meant at what speed we are trying to add that amount of data from your data source to the warehouse is called the velocity. Then the third one is going to be the variety of data. Actually, very simple, in what form we are going to add the data from your data source to warehouse. The best example for that one is going to be the as you know, at what form, which means what kind of format the data is actually, whether it is going to be the structured data, right, or unstructured data, right, or semi-structured data, actually. Right? So what is the unstructured data? You know that there is a rows and columns is been defined for your data. You know that very clearly. Okay, if you're trying to map a pattern for your single row, you can just apply the same thing for the rest of the records. Actually, that is what the structured data. Your data is been organized in the data set in a structured way and very in a rows and columns way. That is the reason we are calling it as a structured data. The best example for this one is your CSV data or your RDBMS tables data, or probably you have just formatted in the Excel and you wanted to just see that one as a structured data, right? That is the best example for the structured data. The next thing is going to be the unstructured data. There is no structure at all for your data set actually. The best example for this one is going to be your PDFs, your audio files, or your video files, right? These are called your unstructured data, right? There is no structure at all. So if you are starting at one place in one record and again next record is going to be starting in the different place with the different data actually. There is no structure. There is a reason audio files, video files, text files, PDFs, all your even the log files are the unstructured data example actually. Then the semi-structured. The semi-structured is nothing but your XML data, right? Half of the only your data is organized, remaining half of the data is not organized, right? So you can see very clearly like your XML files, your JSON files, or your clickstream data. What I mean by clickstream data? Clickstream data is nothing but as you are, for example, you are accessing the Flipkart, right? Behind the screens, they are going to capture your mouse path actually, right? Where you are clicking, what path that you are taking, how many products that you are browsing before you buy your product, those kind of activity they are going to capture behind the screens. That is called semi-structured. Nowadays we started seeing a lot about that one to process your data actually. So this is all about the in what format we are going to add the data from your data source to warehouse, right? The last V is going to be the veracity, right? Veracity, very very important thing. So what is this veracity? Very clear here actually. Veracity, for example, you added 100 GB of data from your data source to warehouse. The warehouse is having 100 GB of data. Now out of 100 GB of data, whatever the data source is sent, you cannot just blindly go ahead and say that is a valid data for you and you would like to process the data actually. There is no way you can see that way, right? So valid data means you have to process it and you have to bring what is the valid and what is the invalid. That's what you have to separate actually. So that is called veracity, right? Separating, extracting the valid data out of your whole data, accurate data, right? Extracting the accurate data out of your entire raw data is going to be the veracity of data actually, right? Veracity of data is nothing but your accurate data actually. So now if you are taking any data set, if the data set is having these four characteristics, right, if the data set is having high in volume of data, right, it's generating terabytes. It's just you are adding the terabytes of data. High in velocity of data, which means in a probably in a week you are adding the terabytes of data from your data source. High in variety of data, the data that's been added in a week, it's going to be the in a different forms actually. It's not a single form that you can just apply the pattern for your data actually, right? And also veracity of data. Veracity is nothing but high in veracity, which means you have to apply the data analytics in order to separate, right, good data, accurate data out of your entire data. That is going to be the veracity. If you see here, if the data set is having these characteristics, high in volume of data, high in velocity of data, high in variety of data, high in veracity of data, then that time we are going to call it as a, the data set is a big data, right? The data set is called big data, right? Any questions from anyone now? So now, if you understood this concept, then you should be in a position to answer in an interview room at least one question actually so far. What is big data? Big data characteristics. We have discussed very clearly here. Go ahead. Any questions from anyone? Clear? Okay. Pramod sir says good. Everything is good. Thank you. Okay. So like I said, you can ask me the question anytime. Okay. So now we are good and we are seeing this much of data from your data source to warehouse. But why this? I mean, when I say MySQL, it does not mean that always you have to go with the MySQL. You can have anything. You can have a Java for the processing part and or probably your data warehousing or your BI tools or your RDBMS, anything, whatever you can just see, this is the your data warehouse actually, right? So now obviously this is being used in order to store the data, in order to process your data in your future purpose actually. So now one thing that you have to understand before I introduce the different technologies to address your big data, we have to understand what is the issue with the existing systems actually, why they have failed to address your big data related issues in terms of storage and processing. So we have to discuss that one first, right? Then only you can move on and discuss with the other technologies or methodologies available in the market actually. You cannot simply go ahead and just say that, okay, because of the existing systems are not able to address your big data related issues, that's how I went to the Hadoop actually. You cannot just say that that is a answer that we cannot give in our interview room. So let's go ahead and see why your legacy systems are struggling. This is all about the big data nature. What is going on with the big data? I'm sorry, I hope you lost me for 3 seconds. Can you all hear me now?
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you. So now let's go ahead and see why your legacy systems are having some issues actually. Yes? Okay. Let's go ahead and see that one. So now you can see very clearly when your data source is generating the data, probably, let me go ahead and just say that, just think like 10 years back, you used to see the 5 terabytes of data, right? Now, in order to handle this 5 terabytes of data here, you have to have some good amount of RAM and good amount of hard drive that is there, right? So now, in order to handle the 5 terabytes of data, we had the RAM as a probably 16 GB or 32 GB RAM, right? 32 GB RAM. So because we are having the good amount, this is a server, this is a legacy system which is having good amount of RAM, and a hard drive probably 10 terabytes of hard drive. So which is good actually, it's a super duper computer, which is good, and you are able to manage your 5 terabytes of data using this server. And you can just serve it, you can serve back to the customers also if they are trying to access anything from the web actually. You are clear on this one, right? But as you know here, you are not only, you did not stop seeing only the 5 terabytes of data here. You started seeing the, right? You started seeing the petabytes of data, right? So now, for example, you started seeing the 50 terabytes of data, for example, after next 2 years or 3 years, right? 50 terabytes of data. So now what you're going to do here? What is the next thing that you're going to get in your mind? Can you handle the 50 terabytes of data using this machine, the existing machine or existing server? Answer is no. Then what is the next thing that we are going to do it? The next thing that we are going to do it simply, we are going to upgrade this system actually. So how we are going to upgrade this one? We are going to just add some amount of RAM, some amount of hard drive, so that I can just, right, I can just see that my machine is going to work for me. So now that is how we are going to add some RAM, some hard drive, so that we are going to just upgrade our system in a vertical way. So now probably I upgraded the RAM that we have from the 32 to the maximum, how much GB that you have? 128 GB is the RAM that you can have, and a hard drive can be 100 terabytes or 50 terabytes when you're going to have a 128 GB as a RAM actually, right? You upgrade your system in a vertical way. You can see very clearly, right? How did you do that one? You upgraded your system to, I need to have the super duper GB RAM and hard drive also. I'm going to have this way, right? Probably I'm just going to have the rough number 80 terabytes of hard drive. So you can see very clearly you upgrade your systems like anything, but you have to spend a lot of money for this one. But of course, so now you are not only seeing the data, only the 50 terabytes of data, you started seeing the more data, because the more customers are started accessing this Amazon actually, then obviously you're going to see the more data from the data source actually. Then what is next actually, right? What is next? So you can see very clearly the amount of data that you are getting from there got increased exponentially, and there is no way you can upgrade your system after this one actually. Probably the next thing that you are going to get in your mind, let me go ahead and upgrade my system, but your system is already reached the peak level actually. There is no way you can just upgrade your system more than 128 GB as a RAM in one slot. One DIMM can have maximum 128 GB RAM. Then after that, there is no way you can increase the capacity of that one. There's no computer as such so far in this computer world to work more than with the 128 GB RAM actually. Then how we are going to do that one? We stuck here actually. This is what exactly the legacy systems are facing the challenges, because of they are following the, they are opting the vertical upgradation. Because they are opting the vertical upgradation, they are not able to just address your big data related issues actually. All your legacy systems are going to follow the vertical upgradation only. That is the main reason why your legacy systems are failing to address your big data related issues actually. Clear? Any questions on this one? So now you got the answer why your legacy systems are failing to address your storage way and processing wise. Okay, all are going to follow the vertical upgradation. Because of that one only, we are not able to address our issues actually. Clear? So now the next thing is going to be how we are going to address them. Yes, we are having the issues with the big data, right? And we are not able to address them using the traditional techniques. Then how we are going to address them? For this guy only, to address your big data related issues, whatever you have, either the storage wise, either the processing wise, in order to address these two issues only, right, they introduced the different methodologies, right? They are called probably Hadoop, right, Spark or Flink. You don't have to know that all these things. I'm just putting the name so that you can understand what are the different technologies, frameworks, languages came into the market in order to address your big data related issues. Hadoop, Spark, Flink, and also we have HBase, which is a NoSQL database. You don't have to worry all these things. I'm going to discuss very clearly, right? ETC, MongoDB, Cassandra, these are the different databases, or probably the frameworks or the languages came into the picture in order to address your big data related issues actually.
So any questions from anyone? Right. We are here to discuss about what is Hadoop and how Hadoop is going to address your big data related issues. That's what we have to discuss here actually. Let's go ahead and see what is Hadoop actually. So Hadoop is going to work basically using the master slave architecture actually. So what I mean by master slave architecture, right? Master slave architecture, right? Master slave architecture. So what I mean by master slave architecture, so we are going to Okay, so now Hadoop is going to work based on the master slave architecture. So what I mean by master slave architecture? Master slave architecture is nothing but you are going to use more than one machine and you are going to make a cluster actually. Let's go ahead and see how that is going to work for us actually. So I'm going to just introduce about the Hadoop. Then we can just go away and tomorrow we are going to continue with that one. So now you can see very clearly, because of the using the single machine, you are not able to just store the data and you are not able to process the data on time using your legacy systems. For that reason only we came all the way with the master slave architecture. What does that mean actually? You can see very clearly. So the master slave architecture, the definition or the example that we are going to have, the way it's going to work is exactly the relation between the project manager and team member. These were the example that I always give to my students, and that's how they can understand very easily this concept. So how the project manager and team members are going to have the relation within the team, the same way you are going to see, right? The same way we are going to see from the other end actually. You can see very clearly. Now this guy is my project manager and all my team members are going to be under his control, and whenever someone wanted to send any work or any work to be done by the team, who is going to get that work initially? Project manager is the one who is going to get it, and team members are the one who is going to really work for him actually. Team member one. So you can see very clearly team member 2, team member 3, clear. I have 4 team members who is going to work for him actually. So they are the one who is going to under control of who? The project manager actually. So now they are going to work within a team actually. They are going to work within a team. You can see very clearly. So now let's go ahead and see how these guys are going to handle. You can see very clearly when someone wanted to send any, your clients wanted to be done your work, then you are going to send it that one to the your project manager. Project manager is the one who is going to distribute that work actually, right? It cannot be done using the single guy actually, right? You have to distribute the work to the multiple people so that multiple people can complete very quickly instead of only one guy is working on top of your data actually. So you can see very clearly the work is same, but you are asking multiple people to work on that task so that you are going to see the results very quickly actually. The end results is provided very quickly actually. That is what the teamwork that you are getting there actually, right? So now there are a few things that you have to understand. One thing is going to be your project manager is the one who is going to be the point of contact for the external world as well as your team members actually. Right, because once the team members have processed the data, they have to share back to the project manager. Project manager are the one who is going to share the end results back. By consolidating the end results, he is the one who is going to share it back to the external world actually. Right, that is the another thing that you have to understand here. The one more thing, if you are not, you cannot go ahead and assign the work directly to the team members, right? That is has to be come from the project manager only. And these all team members are going to be under control of your project manager. If the project manager is not working or is not feeling well, there is no way. You can see very clearly your team is going to become the inaccessible most of the time. I provided you have the, you have to have the backup and all, that is the secondary thing. We are going to handle the same way in our Hadoop side also, but as of now just think through that way actually.
right? So now this is what exactly my master slave architecture also is going to work. So now this is physical machine. Just think like this is a physical machine actually. It's not a simple machine, or it's not a virtual machine that you are achieving here. Physical concept here. So just think like this, each circle is a Hadoop computer actually. Right, it's my Hadoop computer. What I mean by Hadoop computer here, I install the Hadoop software in each and every machine. I just put them together, right? I just connected them using the high reliable cables actually, right? Using very high reliable cables, I connected them together. These my all my Hadoop cluster, Hadoop machines actually, right? Hadoop computer 1, Hadoop computer 2, Hadoop computer 3, Hadoop computer 4. So now this computer, we are going to call it as a master computer, right? Master computer and node both are same. This is called your master computer, and I'm going to call this one as a slave computer actually. They are the one who is going to work really for me. That is the reason I'm calling this one as a slave computer. Slave computer 1, slave computer 2, slave computer 3. So something like that, you can increase how many you want actually. You can see here the way you are putting your computers together, where they interlink together within the network, where they can talk each other. Then that is the reason we are calling this one as a, instead of team, we are going to call this one as a cluster, Hadoop cluster. What I mean by Hadoop cluster, if you are keeping more than one machine, one Hadoop machine together, where they can talk each other, where they are going to work together towards the storage wise issue and processing wise issue in a master slave architecture way, that is the reason we are going to call that one as a Hadoop cluster. It's working in a master slave architecture way actually. Clear? Any questions from anyone? Okay, so this is how exactly how the Hadoop cluster is going to work for us. We are going to see how these 11 machines we are going to put together. And one more thing that you have to understand, this 11 machine, these 4 machines are the one who is going to just be there for you to store your data actually, for you to process your data. The more capacity that you want, simply you are going to add your more system to here actually. The more processing capacity that you want, simply you are going to just add to the system actually. That is what exactly is going to happen in your master slave architecture. You can see your Hadoop is following the vertical upgradation. Instead of following the, I'm sorry, vertical upgradation, it's following the horizontal upgradation. This is called your horizontal upgradation. The more machines that you want, you can simply add the more nodes to the cluster actually. So that is what horizontal upgradation. So Hadoop is following the horizontal upgradation. That is the main reason why Hadoop became one of the best methodology in order to deal with our this thing actually. One of the best methodology to deal with your big data actually, right? So tomorrow we are going to discuss very clearly how this Hadoop cluster is going to address the storage and processing wise actually. In our tomorrow's discussion, we are going to continue with our discussion, and we are going to continue with our class as a first introduction class actually. So any questions from anyone so far? Clear? Lakshman sir, Maurya, Vikram and all, Pramod also. Right? Pramod says, so master computer is not going to store any data. Exactly. Excellent. Master computer is the one who is going to manage something within your Hadoop cluster actually. He is not going to be a part of actual storage. He is not going to be a part of your actual processing also, to be frank. We are going to see that concept, why it is not, but that is how it's going to work out actually. Because it's going to have a lot of responsibilities to manage your data or to process your manage data in your HD, in your Hadoop cluster actually. Clear, Pramod? Okay, so any other questions from anyone? Okay. So if you don't have any questions, thank you so much. I hope I got your all email IDs. Please be in touch with your organizer for more updates. Tomorrow, using the same link, we are going to just continue with our discussion at the same time at 6 a.m. IST tomorrow, right? So tomorrow at 6 a.m. IST, we are going to continue with our discussion. Please use the same link for tomorrow's class. Okay, so if you don't have any questions, we can wind up our today's discussion. Thank you so much for your time, and we'll see you again tomorrow. Thank you, Pramod.
Thank you, Shiv.
Nice talking to you also. Thank you.